Hello, my name is Arnold Tucker. I work in the Netherlands with a large research organization, a not-for-profit organization called TNO. And on top of that, I'm a professor of sustainable innovation at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology in Trondheim, where I also spend part of my time. I want to talk today about how to make the world sustainable and what are kind of boundary conditions to do so. There are a lot of people who think, well, we should stop growing the economy as a main means to stop environmental deterioration. I'm not one of them. And the reason is very simple. I think what we want to achieve is achieving a prosperous or a good life for the future 9 billion or 10 billion people that we will have on the earth by the end of this century. And if you look at the income per capita in countries and you plot that against parameters like the lifetime that people reach, the Human Development Index, that kind of stuff, you see you need something like a $10,000 or $15,000 annual income per head of population. Then on top of that, we know there are countries where the income per capita is already much higher. It will be very difficult to reduce that. So all in all, if you make a ballpark calculation, we need an economy of $200 trillion by 2050 to give everybody on Earth a prosperous life. That is four times the economy of today. At the same time, it has to be a sustainable economy. What really strikes me is that there are loads of activities going on that trying to prove how to make this world sustainable. They are overlapping, they're competing and all this kind of stuff, and I don't like that. So what I propose, and I was very inspired by a professor from Australia, Mike Young, who gave me the following four catchwords. But he said, yeah, you have to make very clear, if you really want to have change, what you want to achieve. You have to make very clear why you cannot achieve it business as usual. You have to make very clear how you want to achieve it, and you really have to basically prove it by examples. He didn't elaborate it, I did it now. And I think there is a kind of agreement on what we want to achieve. If you say we want to have prosperous lives for the 9 billion people on Earth in future, probably everybody will agree. No, there's consensus. Why can't we achieve business as usual? I think there I see already that you need a number of activities. First of all, you see that you have a group called, groups called like the International Panel of Climate Change, the Resource Panel. These are excellently suited, these parties, to indicate what are the physical limits of the Earth, you know, and that's what they should do, nothing more, nothing less. Then we have activities of ecological economics, the Green Economy Initiative, that try to prove something else. They want to show that if we surpass these limits, that at the end of the day, we have economic damage. That's a very powerful story because, you know, at this moment, everybody believes in a growing economy. And if you can show that by environmental deterioration, at the end of the day, we all get poorer, you know, that will move politics. But then again, the Green Economy Initiative, ecological economics should do just that. They should prove that the economic value of the Earth is much more as we see now. Then you come to the part, how are we going to change it? Then you have a program called the 10-year framework on sustainable consumption and production. And then, okay, there you really have to analyze what can we do at the production side, what can we do at the consumption side, and what kind of policy instruments really can make a change. And if all these groups then together say, okay, these are the promising examples, should showcases and whatever, I think then you really have a credible story to tell to policy, to citizens, and to society at large. Thanks.